Hello, Sophie here.
And welcome to the first tutorial of my new Blender pop-up series. So the goal of this series is to design and create a working pop-up book in Blender, be able to draw directly onto that pop-up book in 3D space with grease pencil, and have something that I can print and turn into a physical pop-up, and the printed version will work just like the animated version. So in this video, I'll be explaining how I create a pop-up in Blender using rigid body physics and how I create the two most basic pop-up folds. But first, I would love to give a shout out to the Rigid Body World series by the channel Mr. Cheebs, which taught me everything I know about rigid body physics in Blender, as well as the pop-up channel, which taught me everything I know about pop-up books currently. And I also want to say that I am still figuring this out and tweaking my method pretty regularly. I honestly don't know if this is the best way to go about doing this. This is just the way that I found that worked for me. If you have any suggestions about alternate methods, any tips you'd like to share, all of that would be super appreciated. But for now, let us dive in. So I've opened up a new general workspace in Blender, and I will delete the default cube and add a plane. I can move it along the Y axis with G and Y, and by holding Control, I can have it snap to the increments and exactly straddle the center line of our 3D world. Since I'm trying to emulate paper with this method, I've been using planes, but what's tricky about planes is that if I make the face orientation visible, one side of the plane is blue and the other side is red, meaning that the red side represents the inside of an object. So I don't know the most about 3D objects, but I do know that seeing a red face orientation is typically not great. And indeed, in my early tests, this would give me some issues. And so to get the best results, I like to add a solidify modifier. I can give it a thickness of 0.001 or even 0.0001, and then I will apply it. Now I will select and duplicate this first object, right click to snap it back to its original position, and with the same method as before, I will move it along the Y axis so that it hugs the center line on the other side of the world space. I can rename these two planes book left and book right. Now to create our first rigid body hinge. For this first hinge, the opening and closing of the book, I will just use these two planes themselves. So I can select the left side, and in the physics tab, I will add rigid body physics and make this object a passive type. This means that this object will not move when we run the simulation, but it can impact other rigid bodies. The right side, I will also turn into a rigid body, but keep it active. And then once again to the left side, to the left plane, I will add a rigid body constraint, and I want to make it a hinge type. Hinges are pretty much the only type of rigid body constraint I make use of, and so I will select the plane itself as the first object for this constraint, and the other side, the other plane, as the second object for this constraint. Now, if we run the simulation with spacebar, nothing happens. So hinge rigid body constraints rotate along the Z axis. So in which direction is the Z axis for this plane? Well, I can check that by changing the transform orientations to local, meaning that any transformations I make to an object will be done along that object's unique axes and not the world's axes. So now I can move along the X, Y, and Z axes, and this basically shows me which axis shows up where for that object. So currently the Z axis goes in this direction. But for this hinge to work how I want it to, as a hinge between the two planes, I want the Z axis to be in this direction. So what I can do is first rotate my object 90 degrees along the Y axis. Then I can go into edit mode, A to select all, and rotate along the Y axis another 90 degrees. Our plane is back how it started, but now if I go into object mode and move it along the Z, we can see that now the object's local Z axis is in this direction, exactly what we want. So make sure you're back at the start of your animation. And then before I press spacebar, I recommend saving. I've made it a habit to save before playing an animation because I have had a lot of crashing when I press play. So now that it's saved and that is safe, I will press spacebar again. And we can see that this second plane is rotating around this first plane's point of origin, this orange dot here. So that's not what I want. I would really like for this second plane to rotate around where the two planes meet, like a page opening and closing. So with this book left selected, I can right click and set the origin to the 3D cursor. So the 3D cursor is here. By default, it is found at the world origin, which just so happens to be right between these two objects. And now, we have a fun little page opening and closing hinge. So part of my experimentations were figuring out how to play this animation in a way that would be helpful for me to actually design a pop-up book. And currently, having it fall down is not very helpful. I would need to design a pop-up book while it was dangling upside down. So I can go into the scene properties and open up the rigid body world, and as well open up the field weights dropdown. The first force is gravity, which is the very force that is giving us this current animation, and I can actually change it to be negative. Now when I press play, I have the book closing almost all the way. So for my purposes, I really just want the book to close. I don't want to see it necessarily reopen because then I can just scrub along my timeline one direction or the other. So what I can do is to add in the force fields, just a simple force, move it along the y-axis to the right. I can test it out and I will probably need to raise the strength until the result is my book closing. It's closing and then some, which is honestly fine for my purposes. I really just want to see up until the initial closing and then to be able to reopen it and scrub through those frames. So these settings, these forces, the values, they're all like good enough. I don't want to mess with them anymore, but this is a pretty fast animation. I would like to slow it down a bit, so I can do that again in the scene properties. In the rigid body world, just by changing the speed to something like 0.5. Now I can observe the animation much more leisurely. So with this very basic setup complete, now I want to add pop-ups within the page opening. I will select my right object. With Shift D, I can duplicate it. Right click to snap it back to its original position. I'll switch the transform orientations back to global, and then I want to rotate it along the X axis 90 degrees and also along the Z axis 45 degrees. I will turn on snapping to volume and move it along the Z axis so that it rests just on top of the book page. And then I want to make it smaller, but in order to do that without losing that page touching connection, I can start transforming around the 3D cursor. This is something that I do a lot with this method. So I will go into edit mode. I can toggle X-ray mode with Alt Z. That is this mode here. Just so that I make sure I'm selecting vertices on both sides of the plane, since there is technically some solidify applied to it. So I'll just drag along the bottom here, selecting all of these bottom vertices. With Shift S, I then want to send the cursor to selected. So now the 3D cursor is right along this line at the center of this line. Then I can untoggle X-ray mode, go back into object mode. And now if I select the 3D cursor as my pivot point, I can scale this object down and it's still hugging the bottom page. Now, to hug it against the center line of the two pages, I can have it snap to edges and move it with Y to this point, the center line of the two book pages. Now, to create the other side of this pop-up, I'll go into edit mode again, and this time I just want to select this one corner while I'm in X-ray mode again, Shift S, cursor to selected, Back to object mode, and now I can duplicate, right click, and I don't need snapping currently. I just want to rotate it around the Z axis 90 degrees, minus 90 degrees. And I will take the time to name these two objects and even put them into their own new collection. Now to add some more hinges. So since things are getting pretty complex, I don't want to use the objects themselves anymore. I want to start using arrow empties. So the 3D cursor is already exactly where I want it to be. That is at the inside corner of these two planes. And I will add an empty of arrows. Notice here that the Z arrow is pointing upwards, exactly down the center line of these two pop-up planes. So that is already perfect. I can already give this empty a rigid body constraint, turn it into a hinge, and then just select the two sides of the pop-up as the first and second objects. I can rename this empty for the center of the pop-up's hinge. Now I can duplicate this hinge, right click, and rotate it along the X axis 90 degrees. The Z arrow is here. And then I want to rotate it along the Z axis 45 degrees. So now the Z arrow is perfectly in line with the bottom of the left side of this pop-up. I can rename this hinge pop-up left. And this time I'll set the first target to the left book plane and the second target to the left pop-up plane. We have to do this just one more time, so I'll duplicate this new empty, right click, rotate it along the Z axis 90 degrees again. It is now perfectly aligned with the bottom of this pop-up plane. Rename and change the targets. Now, I will make sure to save. And now we can play back this animation with spacebar. This is always a nerve-wracking moment. And it's not closing as much as it used to. I guess having the pop-up planes be as heavy as the book pages makes the book pages want to close less. Physics. But anyways, I have found better results when I selected the planes and lowered their mass to 0.1 or even 0.01. So now the closing animation is back to what it was before. So now as I'm examining the pop-up closing, I can notice, that's actually pretty impressive, this inner pop-up is like perfectly set up so that it does not at all overlap or like go past the edges of the pop-up book pages when closed. If ever there was an issue with that, with overlap and going over the edges, what I could do is select all of the objects in this collection and move them all with along the X axis. So this is how it might look if the inner pop-up elements did overlap or did go past the pop-up book planes. So that's something that I do pay attention to for printing, because I do want to make sure that my pop-up cards can close and not overlap anything. But I don't mind too much for this demonstration, and actually I want to make sure I have room for the next pop-up, so I'll even move them further back. So now, to finish up this introductory tutorial, I will be adding the other most basic pop-up fold type, the parallel fold. So we just created a V-fold, and what's unique about the V-fold, we can see this with our three hinges, they all converge at the same center point. For the parallel fold, on the other hand, the hinges are all parallel to one another, and so they never converge at any point. So like with the V-fold that we made, I'll duplicate the right book page and right click. Then I want to rotate it 90 degrees along the X axis. So because the 3D cursor is still where it is, and we're still transforming around the 3D cursor as our pivot point, this created something pretty perfect for us. You know, it's hugging the bottom of the page, and it is in the center line of the book. And then I can scale it down. It is still hugging the page how I want it to be. And then another way to start transforming planes that we haven't looked at yet is directly in edit mode. I'll toggle X-ray mode and select the bottom vertices. So now what I can do is actually move them with G and Y to create an angle to our plane. And then I can just go back into object mode, shift D, right click, and rotate this new object around the Z axis 180 degrees. So angle wise, it does line up because of where the 3D cursor was placed, but does not quite line up one side to the other, which would be fine for this demonstration, but I could also use snapping to vertex and move this new plane along the X axis so that it touches the vertex of the other plane and so that they are pretty much mirrored one side on the other. I'll create a new collection for this fold and rename these planes. And I'll also select the two of them without any snapping and move them along the X axis so that the two folds don't intersect with one another. Now for the hinges, I'll add a new empty of arrows and rotate it 90 degrees along the Y axis. So now the Z arrow is parallel to where the two pop-up planes meet one another and also where they meet the book pages. So for this new type of fold, we won't need to change the rotation of the hinges anymore going forward. This time it's the locations that we'll need to change. So I can go into edit mode of this plane, select the bottom vertices, send the 3D cursor there, and then select and send this empty selection to cursor. Send it to the 3D cursor's location. I'll repeat this for the other plane, making sure to duplicate the empty before I move it over, and once more for the center of these two planes. So now all the hinges are in the correct locations, and feel free to pause the video at this point and see if you can set up the hinge rigid body constraints yourself. This is what we already saw with the V-fold hinge setup. Basically, what we want to do is to give each one a rigid body constraint, change the type to hinge, and then assign the first and second objects as the two sides of the hinge. I'll select these pop-up planes and lower their mass to 0.1. Save and press spacebar and ignore the actual interception point, but until that point, what we have is a functional pop-up model that obeys physics that I would be able to print and assemble. So what I really like about this is being able to observe the closing and opening of all of the elements, seeing how they fold into one another, how they maybe overlap, how they maybe even intercept one another. And trust me, if the pop-up elements are arranged in a way that wouldn't be possible in real life, the rigid body constraint sure lets me know it. And there you have the very basics of this system, making everything as simple as I possibly could. Most of the angles are just like 45 degrees or 90 degrees. So in following videos, I will be sharing different ways of creating pop-ups, especially for getting more complex angles, more complex types of folds, and especially folds within folds. But for now, that will be it, and I'd love to know what you think of this. I have been so excited to start sharing this. I have been having such a fun time figuring all of this out, and I hope that this has been inspiring, or at the very least, interesting. The blend files that I worked on in this tutorial are available for free on my Gumroad. If this was valuable for you, consider leaving me a tip or subscribing to my Patreon for a more in-depth look at my painting process with grease pencil. That helps me out a lot, but if you'd prefer not to, then even just liking, subscribing, and sharing the video around also really helped me out. All right, so you can find me all over the internet at Sophie Jantek. I will see you very soon. Take care. Bye.